我们都欢迎这个韩国来的讲者哈，这个 JK。
So, as you've been introduced just now, we're JK and Kulchin. I'm here with my partner, Brian, our We're both civic hackers in Korea, and we're working at this place called Waggle. Waggle in Korean means chatter, chatter, chatter. So the basic idea is more and more discussions. It's a civic tech incubator slash politics startup in Korea. And we were founded just last August, so we're a very, very young organization, especially compared to a renowned institution such as Webster. The basic idea is to change the grammar of politics, not just the people inside it. And our aim is to use a global network, nurture a global network for innovative political experience. And we've got these three missions. I'll let you read the slides afterwards because I want to really focus on the upper part, which is technology for the crowd. I'm going to present on the voter rights applications and a crowdsourced filibuster site that we made during these 4 months. So these are some of the other projects that we've been engaged in. Feel free to ask some questions afterwards. I'll be available for questions. Today, I will be talking about three, unlike what the brochure said, not one, experiments that we did in South Korea in the run-up to the elections in April 13th. While all the three initiatives were kind of different in their own way, I think they share sort of the same mission that our organization is committed to, which is to give a voice to the crowd. But before I do that, let me set the context by telling you a little bit about what Korean politics looks like. And it looks a little like this. That's the billboard, about 30 meters high. And that person's, it's in the middle of Seoul, and he's protesting against press control from the government. The reason he's up there is because the police can't come. The same case happened in a car factory, and clearly he wants to talk. We also protest in numbers. So that was the handful of officials that we had in the main boulevard in Korea. I'm not sure how many, but in the millions, clearly. Of course, the police try to stop us from time to time, but then we hear holograms. And Korea is the second country to have used holograms, just after, I think, Korea, to protest. If you've ever been to, has anyone been to Korea? South. Okay, so that's one, and that's the main goal for the main tourist attraction. So just to put protests into numbers, this is the number of protests that were reported in annually in newspapers. I pulled this from the East Asia Institute. It fluctuates, but it holds, you know, generally, I think. There's a number of statistics from the Korean National Police Agency. It shows that, on average, we have around at least 65 protests per day, week, and 365 days a year. But we don't really vote. We're angry, but we don't vote as much as we used to. Since 1948 to 2012, the turnout for parliamentary elections has continuously declined, with some bumps in the middle, but they have been decreasing every year. And this is especially worse in the younger generation. That's as far back as we have the statistics. Turnout rate for voters under the age of 35. So it's consistently lower than the older demographic. So that's a puzzle to us. If you're angry, why aren't you voicing your opinions in the ballot box, right? One of the hypotheses, no rocket science, is that it's the choice between voice and exit. And this is an idea by Albert Hirschman, who's a microeconomist in the 70s, 80s, and he summarized the problem as follows. If you have a very bad situation, you have one of two choices. You can voice your problem, or you can exit the scene. Therefore, the harder it is to voice your opinions, the more likely you are to exit from the scene. whether it be from a communist republic or from the ballot box. To us, the fall rate of voter turnout seems like an exit phenomenon. So what? I mean, what do we do about it, right? I think one of the things that we saw was two systematic barriers in the political system that made voicing your opinion so hard in the electoral system. And the first barrier is the first past the post system. Everyone's aware of the first past the post system, right? It's contrast to a proportional representation system where you have a national election where all the parties would be aligned in one line. In a first past the post system, you would have each district elect a representative. Therefore, the range of choices that you get is significantly lower. And as you can see, at least 4/5 of Korean MPs come from these FTTP districts. This gives ample possibility for gerrymandering, and lowers the chance that you'll have the right range of choices. But what about the rest of the PRs, right? Proportional representations? Surely they should be able to, you know, give voters a voice. Well, the problem seems to be that you've got too much choice. There is information overload, and it's getting worse and worse and worse. From that's the 18th assembly, that's the 19th assembly, and that's the current election. We've got 21 parties. Just to complicate matters, of course, I think the Green Party has not a sister, but it's got a party with a similar name, named the International Green Party. Apparently, there are about 10 members, all of whom are impossible to come. So the Green Party, for example, had an issue trying to get its agenda out into the open, because in the ballot boxes, they would be confused about which party would be which. So that's clearly information overload. So we've got two barriers. Incumbents already stand out among the 21 parties because that can be back in the list. The order in which they are represented is based on how many seats they have in the legislative assembly. So the party that is incumbent has more clout. Also, when it comes to the FPTP system, it's more likely that you will be able to land favors that will make your district better off rather than making it a whole. So where do we start? To save the suspense, we haven't solved the problem. But we've started from somewhere. We're a very small team. I see a team that's basically me and him, and some designers. So we decided to start with public information that could be scraped with very, very little effort. And thanks to all the parliamentary monitoring organizations that have worked internationally as well as in the nation, in Korea, we've been able to get hold of around 890,000 voting records across 2,900 bills in the past 4 years, while the current parliament, or the to-be past parliament, was in session. And we partnered up with PSPD, which is the largest PMO in Korea. We analyzed voting patterns and discovered that most of the contentious bills tended to be economic in nature. So that related to taxation, corporate governance, labor issues, and such. So we decided to visualize how MPs spread it out on an economic voting dimension. In order to let the voter compare itself to the MP standing for election, we gave the exact same questions to the user as well. So we tried to simulate what they have in the chamber with the colors and the user experience. The result is a simple histogram, again, no rocket science, it's not supposed to be, with all the MPs and the user in one map. And the party affiliations are in blue and red, which are the party colors. The x-axis spreads legislators out by their economic affiliation, so minus 14 is very leftist, plus 14 is very right. There's a social problem with this picture. Obviously, you know, politics happens on more than one dimension. And people ask more questions about civil liberties, nuclear power, gender issues, defense spending, and whatnot. But of course, it's not our fault that they haven't voted on those issues, but we still need to ask those questions. Also, there might be better votes, better ways to calibrate the party's position than just vote, because there are strategic ways of voting in May assemblies. So that's another error that has to be sort of practiced. So we wanted to augment what we do in March. We decided to use a separate questionnaire, 20 questions, then endowed 21 political parties. Ideally, we wanted to do this for all candidates, but we had a total of, I think, 1,500 of them. And the Electoral Commission website is very inconducive, tons of PDFs, and loads, I think, on a GST service, so it's extremely difficult to navigate. So in terms of limited resources, we just had to stick to a manageable number, which was 21. Following advice from academia, we divided the questions up into four categories: diplomatic, that's related to North Korea, and America; social, which is related to the right to protest, freedom of expression and such; economic, which I just explained; and ecological, which goes to issues such as gender equality or nuclear power and issues of such. We've been working with a media partner as KCIJ, that's the largest investigative journalism outfit in Korea. And they sent out all those lovely faxes to the parties. That's, I think, the Labor Party answer sheet. And afterwards we harassed them, of course, with the number of phone calls so that they could attack us. We got about just over half of the parties. Most of the important parties were there. And we use the same sort of distance scaling methods used by apps in Germany and the Netherlands to calculate one-dimensional similarity scores between the users and the parties. We also try to contextualize this in a multi-dimensional setting, because, as I said, the problem with Ping 1 was that it was just unidimensional. If you say, are you a rightist or a leftist, you have to ask on what dimension. So this is basically what it does. If you go onto the site, you will discover at the end that you can change the axis, and then you can find out basically six combinations, 4C, 2 equals. Six combinations, how you compare it with all the other parties. So this was a new thing in Korea, so it did generate some buzz. Around 130K users made use of the site and got press coverage in it on TV. We got coverage from Huffington Post also. But I think what's really more interesting to us is that we got a lot of policy discussions that we didn't have beforehand on parties. If you look into trade news, current political news, most of the stuff you will find is someone betrayed who, and that person then went on to join someone else. And that person is the heir apparent of someone else. So it's a very personal sort of way of looking at politics. But I think getting some policy discussion was something quite significant. The reason I think that was the case was because people often got different results. And some people got really, that's a Sankey diagram, of the left-hand side being the party that they thought they were most affiliated to, and the right-hand side being the party that matched the best in the app. Unsurprisingly, people were surprised, some were angry, they wrote to us saying that this was a piece of something. Some were baffled. Some other people were grateful that they didn't actually know that this party stood in this way on this on certain issues. But above all, they all became, I think, more engaged and attuned to the party manifesto. And while I don't claim to have influenced this just by myself, the voting rate for the 20s for this election luckily has had an increase, and we've seen a lot more turnout for this election than the last. I promised you that I would talk about three. I just talked about two, so here comes the next portion. PhDs are great. But votes are a very indirect way of influencing politics. I think another way to voice your opinion is through blogs, tweeting, getting on a soapbox, and even better, to enter the chamber of the National Assembly herself, as she did in the Sunflower Movement in 2014, right? We didn't literally do that, but we had an app that allowed us to reach out to our legislators inside the chamber. So the basic idea is to channel people's voices into a single microphone and connect that to an audio system inside the parliament building. And we did that in the context of the world's longest filibuster. Is everyone familiar with the term filibuster? Is anyone aware of the term filibuster? Great. I will let Wikipedia be talking. So a filibuster is a parliamentary procedure where debate over a proposed piece of legislation is extended, allowing one or more members to delay or entirely prevent a vote on the proposal. It's basically talking for a very long time until the bill dies, or talking the bill to death. Why do we do that? Because I think we've had enough fights in Korea, in Japan, in Taiwan. Anyone from Ukraine? No. It's a sport. We're not that much behind us. So, reminds you of 2014. The filibuster provides an alternative to fight clubs. And you can voice your opinion, block the bill for a while to raise public awareness. The context is as follows. In the last session of the National Assembly before the election, the ruling party took the initiative and submitted an anti-terrorism bill, in quotation marks, that would grant wide-ranging surveillance powers to the intelligence services, so our version of the Patriot Act from America. In response, the opposition party staged a filibuster that lasted for 192 hours. That is a world record, I did check. To stop the bill from getting to a vote. When the speaker was about 3 hours into his first speech, we thought that something was happening. The blue line there, in Google search trends, is the filibuster, and that's the search trend for 2016. The red line is Sonyeoshe, if you're aware of him. No one's aware of Sonyeoshe? SNSD? Okay, maybe not. The yellow line is the sitting president. And the green line is Tsui from Twice, who had that political problem back in the TV show. And the purple, everyone's nodding there, the purple is Running Man, which is a popular TV show, I think. So you can see that the filibuster clearly has been eating all of them. And if you look at Naver, which is the biggest search engine in Korea, the same kind of holds. The green line is the president. The purple line is SNSD, which is the goal. We had offline sort of homages to the people that were speaking inside the chamber. We had online filibusters. We had a YouTube streaming service. But the mainstream media just didn't care. And this is pulled out of the Korea Press Foundation. And you can see the same stats for the issues that I, for the terms that I searched this last time. So the filibuster is in light blue, and SNSD is in black. The sitting president is in green. The ruling party is in orange. And the dark blue is the opposition party. So clearly, that guy's sleeping, by the way. They didn't care. So there's a contrast, clearly, because the chamber is empty, but people are queuing up to go and watch. So, as you can see, there is a gap in need. And there is also a concurrence of need between speakers and citizens. There is a need for people to participate in whatever form, shape, and way possible. On the other hand, the legislators needed more text to read from and to delay the process as much as possible. So that's where filibuster.me came. It's a crowdsourced speech writing site, custom made for legislators. I'm just clapping. Sure. I I still don't know how to say it. I don't speak Chinese. Photos or dummy connects these two entities, and we transitioned into archive mode, so you won't see the same UX that we had up there. But in short, it's a one-page site, and it only took us about 6 hours to get it up and running. Those are the actual speeches, and you wouldn't believe that people actually type on their mobile phones for that long. But they really have. In fact, around 38,000 people, and we had about 170,000 unique visitors. That just came in about 10 days. The National Assembly staffers on the ground would actually go into the site and scrape the speeches that were there, because they were really up to legislative quality. They could actually do those things. They didn't have any swear words. They were very, very academic. I saw Foucault, Orwell, Greece, authoritarian past, resistance to poetry, all sorts of ideas and things that they put forward. And at that point, that's incredible when actual legislative, actual MP, Kim Jong-un, she actually asked on social media for her supporters to write on the filibuster document, which made it a two-way vote. Of course, it only lasted for 10 days, so, and the bill passed. So I guess this is the time to stop take. Have we leveled the playing ground? No, as I've said, we haven't solved the problem per se. These, despite so-called achievements, haven't really produced real political change. In Philadelphia's case, the bill was entered into law. In Pink's case, the smaller parties, such as the Green Party, didn't make it. So information clearly isn't enough. As Clay Shirky said, you need some more solidarity. On the other hand, I think there's a more optimistic interpretation. It's a step for something bigger. 75% of our user base, or over it, was younger than 35. Both our products created significant contagion, and those are sites that all were sprung up within 3 or 4 days to archive, petition, stream, and talk about the filibuster. Also, we had 4 DAAs in Korea that were launched just after, only after we released ours to the mainstream media. So, in short, I think we may have failed, but I think we failed quite well. In this election, people knew what issue they were voting for, what legislators were voting on, what bill was being passed by inside their vote. And echoing, I think, Lord Kelvin's quote there, you can't improve something that you don't know. Now that we're more aware, I think the groundwork is laid for something more there, and we'll keep on experimenting. That's all. Thanks. That's an extremely important question, and the short answer is yes. The question was, did you check whether these positions were actually true, and did you check their public statements or their legislative records? And we cross-checked whether they actually did. One party, which was a Christian liberal party, I think, said that they were for gender equality, i.e. homosexual marriages, and we thought that was strange. So we called them again, showed them their manifestos, and it happened to be that someone slipped their pen while they were answering the questions. Two parties didn't answer. The ruling party didn't give papers. So we had to actually go into their public speeches, their party platforms, their manifestos, their voting records, to figure out what their actual positions were. We were very explicit in the methodology sections about which statements we use for the basis of such a categorization.
I think that would depend on what comes out
in the elections. For example, if you had Trump versus Trump, you know, turnout wouldn't be that high. But in this case, we still have a year to go, and because we don't have the primary process as long and drawn out as the American system, it would still be in the air until the end. We have to keep in mind the election forecasts for this election were all wrong, especially in terms of the voter turnout.
Thank you.